So I'm going to, I've been a physician for 30 years, and I've been a teacher in some capacity or the other for an equal duration of time. I'm now gray in the gills, and sometimes have to grope for words. And you would think that I should be knowing it all, but this is far from the truth. And in the words of Ulysses, I can say that yet all experience is an arch, where through gleams that untraveled world, whose margins fade forever and forevermore. Ladies and gentlemen, I've learned to be a doctor, I've learned to teach medicine, and all along I've discovered that this is a process which is still continuing, it's a process in evolution. And more than that, I've discovered that learning medicine is just not gathering a whole lot of data or learning some practical skills. It is learning to be a new individual, to be a new person. In the next few minutes, I'm going to talk to you about how my learning started. In fact, my learning to be a doctor started much before I joined the medical college. It was the June of 1982, and I was facing the AFMC interview board. I entered the room, and there was this interview panel, and there was a man who looked like Dumbledore, except he didn't have a beard. And he was the dean of AFMC, at that time, General CSV Subramaniam. I barely sat down on my seat, and he threw his first question at me. Young man, what are your interests? So I mumbled timorously, reading. And the next question was, well, have you read Charles Darwin? And that was where the viva started. The next 15 minutes were only a discussion on the behavior of finches and the Galapagos Islands. As I got up to leave the interview, this is what he told me. He said, to be a doctor, you have to be well-read. You have to know about the world. You have to know about the people. If you don't know it, you cannot relate to your patients. Later, when I joined medical college, I discovered that this eminent pathologist was not only a great authority in his field, but he could also talk with great conviction and knowledge about the Tsars of Russia, about Buddhism, and also the fine art of brewing beer. Now, when I joined college, in the first year, there were two teachers who had a great impact upon me. And they were diametrically opposite personalities. One was the head of, and they were light years apart as far as a career, as a character went. One was a head of anatomy, and Dr. V.R. Mysorkar, and the other was a reader in physiology, Major K.K. Prem Kumar. Dr. Mysorkar was dramatic, and his voice would move from, you know, a whisper to high falsetto in his classes. He would twist and turn in his classes, and he would make human embryology come alive. The fusion of the mesoderm and ectoderm seemed so simple. In contrast, Dr. Prem Kumar was low-pitched, and he was a very, very introverted personality. In his classes, there would be pin drop silence. The students would hang on to every word that he uttered. He used to draw these amazing diagrams with color chalks on the blackboard, and they would make physiology come alive. These two diametrically opposite personalities shared one thing in common, and that was that they were able to pique our curiosity and stimulate us to learn by their powerful visual imagery. Over years, I've realized that visualization is an important component of learning how the body works and how medicine works. And I think that this was a very, very important lesson they taught me. Not only did they teach us this power of imagery, but in their classroom, it was like being in the presence of consummate actors who were communing with their audience. And this was because of the great passion they brought into the teaching. And this passion was infectious, and this passion was like a tsunami. It just swept you away. Now, moving from the first year of medicine to the second year when we entered the clinical rotations, I was exposed to Colonel Prem Chip. Colonel Prem Chip was a reader in the Department of Medicine. And his, as a fourth term student, just entering clinical rotations, it used to be a difficult task to attend his clinics because there would be senior students who would crowd around him. Students, 36 students would stand in banks of four, oblivious to the heat and discomfort, listening, trying to hear what he was saying. This man was, again, a very soft-spoken, reserved individual. But he used to teach something. He used to teach valvular heart disease to us. And when he used to teach valvular heart disease, valvular heart disease and medicine changed from being just a conglomerate of similar signs and symptoms to something more tangible. You know, by the evoking power of logic and reasoning, he made medicine seem as beautiful as mathematics. It seemed that, you know, if you could reason out and you had rational thinking, it was as simple as joining dots. And diagnosis in cardiology was as simple as this. Now, if I were to quote Isaac Newton, I would not be wrong in saying that if I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulder of giants. This good medical education at AFMC shaped me. It is not surprising that being inspired by these people, I chose to become a physician. Becoming a physician and working as a physician was a cakewalk. I enjoyed every moment of it. My life changed when I came back to AFMC as a faculty member. And then I had to start relearning all over again. Now I have to learn how to be a teacher. And learning to be a teacher was not easy. As a teacher, you are constantly under the lens. You are constantly being scrutinized by your seniors, by your students, undergraduate and postgraduate alike. They keep watching everything you do. To be a good teacher, it is not only just to be able to do everything that you say. If you expect your students to do something, you have to do it yourself. That is more important. And you have to be careful that whatever you say will come back to you at some stage or the other. And I realized this when I was talking to a postgraduate student of mine many years later. Now, I used to look after the adventure club in AFMC, and I used to take students out on treks regularly. And it was many years later at a party, I met one of these old students who had been an active member of the adventure club. She was now a resident in microbiology, and we were chatting at the party. She took out a piece of paper from her handbag, crumpled it, and threw it on the ground. Her five-year-old child, who was with her, swooped down, picked it up, and then scolded the mother, "Mama, don't litter." My resident smiled at me and said, "Sir, you will not remember, but 10 years ago when we joined the Adventure Club, you taught us this. And now this knowledge has been passed on to the next generation." Now, what you tell to your students can be really scary sometimes. Another postgraduate student, having completed his MD medicine, was posted to a hospital in remote Northeast. So he called and he was complaining about the remoteness of the place and how difficult it was to practice medicine over there, saying that there are not enough cases and all. So I was telling him that probably this is a very good time now to focus on your family. You have a two-year-old son. Why don't you now plan to have another child? He said, "No, sir, I'm happy with one child." The topic was dropped and the conversation veered on to other subjects, and the call ended. 2 months passed and I get a call from him again. And he says, "It is done, sir," smugly. And I'm totally disoriented and ask him, "What?" And he looks at me and says, "Sir, the baby is due in 7 months' time." And that left me totally speechless. So, you know, what you say to your students, be careful. It's very, very important. Now, to practice medicine, you have to walk the talk. If you want your students to do something, you expect something from them, be first sure that you are doing all that yourself. And practicing medicine is walking up a long, steep climb. There are no shortcuts in medicine. You cannot lose 10 kilos weight in a matter of 1 week. Normal gestation takes 9 months. If that is so, why cut corners? Follow the narrow, straight path, and you will not be wrong in medicine. This is very, very important to remember, that medicine is not easy to practice. Now, General Madhuri Kanitkar, who is a dean of AFMC today, she was the head of pediatrics when I first started working with HIV/AIDS many years ago. And at that time, one day we bumped into each other after lectures, and she said, "Come with me, I have something to show you." So she took me to her Maruti car, opened the boot of the car, and there I saw these stacks of files in the car. And she said that, you know, these are all records, case records of my pediatric nephrology patients, and I carry them wherever I go. So, you know, you are now launching onto a new career in a new field. Keep records. And so I started keeping records. Now, keeping records may sound easy if you have 5 secretaries or data entry operators with you. But if you have to do it yourself, it is not easy. Finishing teaching commitments, seeing an OPD, and then maintaining, writing down detailed summaries of patients is a lot of hard work. And if you are doing this, skipping lunches on a regular basis, it leaves you dizzy. I used to write the summaries. Then every fortnight on a Sunday afternoon, I would start taking out the summaries and feeding the data onto my laptop. And that was even worse, because it would be so time-consuming. If you thought this was enough, worse was to follow, because when you feed data, you realize that some vital information is missing. Then tracking those patients, getting this data, was another big ordeal. My family used to think I was crazy. I thought I developed obsessive-compulsive disorder, but I persisted. Now, in 2009, I was attending a high-altitude medicine conference in Leh, and there was this presentation being made by an old postgraduate student on high-altitude pulmonary edema. At the end of the talk, I went up to him and complimented him on his work and said I was really proud of him. He said, "Sir, if you have 5 minutes, come with me to my office." So he took me to his office, and when I went to his office, he switched on his laptop, and one data sheet flashed on the screen. And he said, "Sir, when I was a student, I was inspired by how you used to maintain your HIV data diligently, and that's what I've been doing over the years." So I was glad that something that I'd done had had an echo in the future. Now, if this is hard work, this is not all. To be a doctor, we have to constantly keep learning. Medicine, I keep saying, is a career of lifelong learning. And I had this colleague who was a brilliant endocrinologist, Colonel Ajit Kashyap. He was the most diligent scholar I've known in my life. Every lunch break, he would be in the library, poring over the latest issues of journals or the new textbooks, and he would not eat lunch. He would just have two fruits on his table. He would munch them and keep reading journals. Now, this brilliant career was cut short when he had a seizure at work one day. An MRI scan was done. It showed a large astrocytoma in the brain. He went off to US to get a brain surgery done. Then chemotherapy followed. He got transferred out. I got transferred out. And we lost touch with each other. Many years later, I was posted in Delhi. And I heard that he had been readmitted in Army Hospital Research and Referral with a recurrence of his tumor. I went to visit him. This was around a month before he died. He was in poor shape. He had hemiparesis on one side. He had raised intracranial tension. He was confused, and he was not able to recognize me. Yet, the new edition of Harrison was open on his bed, and he was sitting looking at it and puzzling over the latest changes in the book. And that is an image which is seared in my memory forever, saying that, you know, it is so important to continue learning throughout your life. Now, if this is there, then I will go on to something different now. And that is that medicine is such a demanding career that to prevent burnouts, we need to have other interests. Today, I'm very fortunate that I'm starting the first talk, and the last talk is by Dr. Murad Lala, and he is also a mountaineer. We share a common passion. And for me, you know, the problem is not having one interest, but having too many interests. I like climbing and trekking. I travel all over the world in search of great art and architecture. And I also collect mountain stamps. And that is the reason that all the slides in my presentation have only stamps on them today. Now, for me, among all these passions, the one which works best for me is mountaineering. Because mountaineering does something else for me. You know, at 6,000 meters, when you're battling with hypoxia and the cold, there is no time to think about your work pressures. You have a complete break from work. And this break from work helps you reboot and recalibrate yourself. And that's great about having a passion in life. Now, mountaineering does something else, that it gives you time to reflect in tranquility. Reflecting in the mountains, I reflect on life and beauty. But reflection is also an important part of medicine. And in medicine, when you think or reflect about what you have done, what adverse events have occurred in your wards, it's the time you will be able to realize what went wrong, recalibrate your work, and probably re-strategize your techniques. So that is an important point. Reflection is very important in medicine. Now I move on to something less serious, but equally important. And I will talk to you about another colleague of mine, Dr. Vardarajalu. Dr. Vardarajalu was an astute physician and an effortless neurologist. But these were not his greatest qualities. His greatest quality was that he could see a name in a crowd. If you saw a crowd, every face in the crowd had a name. He had a phenomenal memory, and he was able to remember everybody in college. For him, students were not roll numbers, but they were unique people. This is something that I've tried to emulate over many years, trying to get to know all my students by name, learning about their backgrounds, learning about their thoughts. I keep wondering that if we did not invest in our students and get to know them by name, then we should not be surprised if our students refer to their patients as hernias and appendices. You know, unless we teach them that they are unique entities, we cannot expect them to treat their patients as unique entities. So this was an important lesson that I learned from him. Now, next thing is that it's not important just to know them by their name. It is important to be available to them. Being available to them, not only to clear their doubts after lectures, but also to dispel their fears and also to stay the course. I'll tell you about one student who is very close to me and special to me. This was a boy who was an unwilling entrant into medical school. His heart was set on journalism, but his parents thought otherwise and sent him to AFMC. Being an intelligent student, it was not difficult for him to clear the exams, but his heart was not in it. He raged, kicked, screamed, and of course bunked classes and clinics. In his final term, he realized his inadequacies caught up with him, and he discovered that now he was like a skier on a downhill journey, and he was not able to arrest his fall. He came and said, "Sir, I want to drop out from medical school. I know nothing in medicine. I can't clear my final year exam." It took a lot to convince him to stay on and to get him exam ready. He finished his graduation, went on to do his internship, and during his internship, he discovered that he actually enjoyed dealing with patients, and this was his true calling. After his internship, he was posted as a regimental medical officer in a unit in Arunachal Pradesh. There, he diagnosed a child with rheumatic heart disease, organized money for a treatment, got her over to AIIMS Delhi, and got valve replacement surgery for the child done. Now, I came to know of all this from newspaper clippings that he sent to me, where his entire actions had been recorded and traced. And for me, that was an uplifting moment. I realized that my faith in my student had been vindicated. It also taught me another important lesson. Never give up on your students. You know, you never know, for every student, the spark will turn into a fire, the fuse will come on at a different time, and you can never predict it. So always have faith in them and push them on. Next important thing is that you should be able to mentor them. Mentor your students, fuel their dreams, egg them on, revel in their achievements, you know, and try to get them breaks in their career as far as possible. It is important because as a teacher, your achievement is only a sum of all their accomplishments. Thank you very much.